Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to this new series about the hadith, the dark cloud that has covered and crooked Allah's path and made it more complicated than Allah intended. In so many ways, you hear today that anything that you do in Islam is based on the Messenger of Allah said. It is sunnah to do that. You never ever hear this is the sunnah of Allah or this is what Allah commands. Why do you eat with the left hand? Well, the hadith says, why do you enter the bathroom or the toilet with the left leg? That's because, again, the hadith, why do you dress in such way? Why when you dress, you say some things? Why when you, everything, even to the point where even when you sleep with your partner, instead of enjoying sex as Allah has given to us, what do? We waste our time and the energy and the concentration in making dua. Subhanallah, at that very moment, and where it happens, la ilaha illallah, at the time of orgasm, when you are guys orgasming, that's when you make certain dua, ya Allah, prevent us from a shaitan, prevent shaitan from what you gave us. Did Allah say that? If this was as important as that sounds, why didn't Allah mention this in the Quran? Why? Well, as it turns out, throughout history, the Quran was not always on the back seat. Well, actually, for so many months or years, so to speak, it was always at the forefront, and also at the time of Rasulullah, it was always at the forefront. Even so, to where our mother Aisha said, "Kana khuluqu al-Qur'an," the characteristics, what described the Prophet Muhammad was al-Qur'an. And then she said, he was a walking Qur'an. So, if he was a walking Qur'an, why wasn't he a walking hadith? Why wasn't he the manifestation of hadith? Because at the time of Rasulullah, they didn't have something called the Quran and the hadith. They never came to Rasulullah and they say, oh, Allah says this, what do you say? Even in our books of history, they mentioned the story of one day a man, where Rasulullah did good to him, and the man said, oh, thanks to Allah and to you. And they say that the messenger got very angry. He said to him, did you make me equal partner with Allah? Say, thanks to Allah, then to you. And you find this in Salafi, where they emphasize always on that then. So if at the time of Rasulullah, nothing compared to the Quran, why is it when he died, again, nothing compared to the Quran? Until Muawiyah came, and suddenly the Quran slowly started moving to the back seat, and by the 3rd century, the Quran was completely at the back seat, especially after the big incident, when they always tell you that the Mu'tazila, the big troublemakers in the Muslim world, said that the Quran is created. But they never tell you why Al-Mu'tazila reached that point. Well, I will tell you all in this series. I will tell you about Abu Huraira, why he mentioned so many hadith when we don't even know his real name. We don't even know where he comes from. And all the political misdeeds that he did, money that he stole. Umar ibn al-Khattab, why did he beat up on Abu Huraira? And Umar, why did he burn everything that the companions had documented about the messenger? More so, why do we have more hadith about what happened in al-Madinah and we have zero hadith of what happened in Mecca? We know absolutely nothing about what happened in Mecca except what the Quran says. And some far-fetched story, Quraysh said this and did that. Why? If you look at the hadith and how it was compiled, you would think that people that have been with the messenger from day one would narrate more hadith than those people that came towards the end of Islam, right? For example, if I take Khadija, she doesn't have a hadith at all. Nothing at all. Even the way he married her, with the messenger married Khadija, we have different conflicting stories. The story says this, the other story says that. Ali is a little kid who grew up with the messenger in Mecca. And they always tell you the story that when the messenger migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah, he left Ali in his dwelling, right in his place, to fool Quraysh. But Ali, in all the hadiths that we have, doesn't have over 50 hadiths. Subhanallah. Ali has witnessed all the life of Rasulullah. He went out with him in every expedition except one. He married his daughter. He is the father of the grandchildren of the messenger. But you know nothing about Ali. So much so that there is this historical embargo upon us. That if you talk about Ali, you must be a Shia. And if you are Shia, you are Iranian. And if you are Iranian, you are against the Sunnah. And if you are against the Sunnah, you are against Islam. That's it. That's how Islam is. Our minds are so controlled that we cannot even ask intelligent questions. In this series of the Hadith, the dark cloud, it certainly is. Quran is light. Quran is straight path. But the Hadith came down on us with the darkness. If you've seen the Lord of the Rings, when you go, the closer you get to Mordor, where Sauron is, what happened is darkness thickens. And the farther away from Mordor you are, the lighter you go to the Shire. It's green, it's beautiful, it's this and this, right? Well, exactly the same thing. The closer you get to the Quran is Islam is easy, beautiful. When you make your wudu, you don't have to wash your feet, you just wipe over them. That's what the Quran says. But if you do it today, they will tell you, you do like the Shia, then you must be Shia, and then. So you see how the Quran is put at the very back seat with some political agenda to justify certain things. Many hadith, Aisha, you know, she's mentioned a few thousand hadiths, and then they tell you the Messenger of Allah married so many of his wives so that we know about his life, and each woman of his wives will tell a story about him, right? Wrong. We only know few. Aisha mentioned a few things. She's on the top six that mentioned so many hadiths. That's that. The other rest of the wives of the Messenger, we got nothing about them. Why? Because of political influences. Those that were pro-government of that time, i.e. Muawiyah and so on, and then after that the Umayyad and the Abbasid dynasty came forward, just like today in Saudi Arabia. Who is still preaching Islam? Who still gives talks in Haram Makkah? Those that are pro Mohammed bin Salman, every sheikh out there that is pro Saudi government, the royal family, is still active. Those that are anti this family, guess where? They are in jails. This has been the case throughout history. And I said once in one of my talks, no, I don't think talk, but I said this in the wisdoms, in the quotes that I mentioned one day, that if history has been played with in the past, and I mean that, how can we trust history when today the present is violently forged in front of our own very eyes? And I say, don't take your Islam from history or hadith, because history is nothing else but hadith disguised. If you want to know exactly what took place at that time, look at the different hadiths. When they want to invade a country, they fabricate hadiths about that country and they invade it, and then they make it a sign of the hour that the Messenger spoke the truth. When they conquered Jerusalem, when Omar conquered Jerusalem with the armies, later on they made the conquering of Jerusalem a sign of the hour. Why? Because it happened. They wanted Jerusalem, so they had to find the hadith. In the early days, they didn't have, oh my God, I can go a lot of things. But in this series, every time I will talk about why hadith sahih, what they mean with the mutawatir, the group hadith, the chain of narrators, why is Bukhari different than Muslims, why this, why that, you will get by the end of this series, that I will keep under 9 minutes as well, you will get a good idea about why the hadith belongs far more at the back, the very back of a bus, and the Quran should drive the bus all by itself. On judgment day, always remember, the only book of authority against which Allah will hold you responsible for your deeds is the Quran. There will be no Bukhari, no Muslim, and no nonsense at all. This series will indulge you in more than that. So I will give the talk, and I will post the notes when possible, so that you have something spoken and something written for your attention. And by the end of the series, bi-idhnillah, you will have a good grasp about this very manipulative science called the hadith. And to me, as far as I'm concerned, the Quran is a dark cloud. Assalamu alaikum.